I like killing people because it is so much fun. It is more fun than killing wild game in the forest, because man is the most dangerous animal of all. To kill something gives me the most thrilling experience. It is even better than getting your rocks off with a girl. The best part of it is when I die, I'll be reborn in paradise, and all that I have killed will become my slaves. I will not give you my name, because you will try to slow me down and stop my collection of slaves for my afterlife. In July of 1969, a letter arrived at the San Francisco Examiner newspaper containing those exact chilling words in a coded message. At the time, the people of Northern California did not see the terror that was waiting for them. The Zodiac, a serial killer who terrorized Northern California in the late 1960s and early 1970s, would shock the world and scar Northern California with a combination of horrific murders, public letters with horrifying threats, questionable demands, and mysterious ciphers teasing his identity. For 5 decades, the identity of the Zodiac Killer has remained a mystery. A mystery that countless criminologists, codebreakers, and law enforcement officials have tried to crack. In this episode of The Most Dangerous Animal of All, we cover the inspiration behind this series' name, the Zodiac Killer, one of the most terrifying serial killers of all time. In early June 1963, on a Tuesday, Robert Domingos and his fiancée Linda Edwards, two seniors at Lompoc High School in Santa Barbara County in Southern California, decided to partake in Senior Ditch Day. The couple planned to go sunbathing on a beach. However, the next day, when the pair did not return, their parents grew worried. Eventually, Robert's father went to the beach to look for the two teenagers, but he was met with horror instead. He discovered the bodies of the two dead teenagers lying together in the remains of a crumbling shack. The two were bound together with rope, and while they tried to escape, had been shot to death. Robert was shot 11 times, and Linda was shot 9. There was evidence of the killer trying to start a fire after dragging their bodies to the shack, but the killer had failed to start the fire. With little leads, the investigators were unsure of who the killer could be. A few years later, it was discovered that this was most likely the Zodiac Killer's first victims before his terrifying killing spree through Northern California began. The Zodiac Killer is believed to have committed 37 murders total, but only 7 have been confirmed. While the case mentioned earlier is believed to be linked to the Zodiac killings, the first official case of the Zodiac killings began on December 20th, 1968, when 17-year-old David Faraday and his 16-year-old girlfriend Betty Lou Jensen were shot to death near their car at a remote spot on Lake Herman Road. Only 5 nights before Christmas, the pair were set to go on their first date together and had promised their parents that they would be back by 11 p.m. However, when 11 p.m. passed, the teenagers were still not at home. A passing motorist would soon discover their lifeless bodies in the car parked at the Lover's Lane spot along Lake Herman Road. Another driver also noticed their lifeless bodies and called the police. Betty Lou had been shot 5 times in the back, but her partner, David Faraday, had only been shot once in the head. He was still breathing at this time, but shortly died after. The same type of gun that had been used to kill Robert and Linda was used to kill Betty Lou as well. Also similar to the last case, the police were unable to determine much for the case, as there seemed to be no prime suspect or motive in the case. When looking at the next victims of the Zodiac Killer, this case gets even more chilling. On the night of July 4th, 22-year-old Darlene Farron picked up her friend, Michael. The two were in the parking lot of Blue Rock Springs Park when another vehicle pulled in right next to them. At first, the pair did not suspect much, as the car soon left. However, the car soon returned a few minutes later, and this time when the car returned, the driver got out. The driver ended up getting out and shooting Michael in the jaw, shoulder, and leg. The killer also shot Darlene several times. The killing is believed to have occurred a few minutes after midnight, and at around 12:40 p.m., a man rang the Vallejo Police Department and reported the crime. This man later confessed to the police that he was the one who shot Darlene and Michael, and he also had committed the killings on Lake Herman Road. While Darlene died on the way to the hospital, Michael survived. He was sadly unable to identify any suspects for the killings. After the murder of Darlene and the attempted murder of Michael, the letters began trickling in. At first, three identical letters were sent. The first one was sent to Vallejo Times Herald on July 31, 1969. In the letter, the writer claimed responsibility for the two shootings. They gave descriptive details about the victims, the weapons, and other chilling details related to the murders. The second identical letter was sent to the San Francisco Chronicle, and this letter accompanied one-third of a cipher. The writers of these letters demanded that the letters and ciphers were published by Friday, August 1st. The third and last letter was sent to San Francisco Examiner. Again, the writer sent threats and included that if the newspaper did not publish the cipher and the letters, they would kill again. This letter also stated, "I like killing people because it is so much fun." One more letter was sent to the Examiner on August 4th, 1969. The letter was 3 pages long and sent in response to the police. The police had asked the writer of these letters for information to prove that the writer was responsible for the murders. This letter is significant as it is the first time the killer used the name The Zodiac. The Zodiac would eventually strike again on a Saturday in late September. College students Brian Hartnell and Celia Shepherd were relaxing along the shore of a lake some 30 miles north of Napa, California. A man wearing a hooded costume with a white cross circle stitched over it appeared with a gun threatening the pair. The man explained that he had escaped from a prison and needed money and a car to escape to Mexico. The hooded man bound their wrists, but suddenly he began to plunge a large knife into Brian's back. He stabbed Brian 6 times. The man then grabbed Cecilia and stabbed her 10 times. The man went to Brian's car and left the police chilling messages on the side. He wrote the dates and the locations of the previous attacks. He finished off by writing a cross circle on the door, the same symbol that the Zodiac Killer had used to sign his letters. About an hour later, a man called the Napa Police Department to report a double murder. The police tried to track his phone as they had done with the last shooting, but they were unable to locate the man. Celia died 2 days later, but Brian survived the attack. After this event, the Zodiac Killer took what is officially marked as his last and final victim, Paul Stein. He was a 28-year-old student and husband and worked as a taxi driver in San Francisco. On October 11, 1969, Paul Stein picked up a passenger. This passenger ended up shooting Stein in the head and taking a piece of his clothing. During this incident, the police believed that the passenger was a black man, and it is believed that the real killer, who was a white man and fit the description, had passed the officers. The killing of Stein was believed to be a robbery until the San Francisco Chronicle received another letter labeled by the Zodiac. It began with, "I'm the murderer of the taxi driver." The envelope also contained a blood-stained piece of Paul Stein's shirt. The Zodiac Killer once again got away, and this time he was right in front of the police's nose. The Zodiac continued sending letters to the newspapers, all of them including threats and ciphers. After the murder of Paul Stein, there were 2 more possible Zodiac killings. There were also numerous other letters with threats and ciphers. In these letters, the Zodiac claimed that he had continued to kill. In March of 1971, the Zodiac Killer sent the Pines postcard and Los Angeles letter. These were his last communication to the public before going on a 3-year hiatus. On January 31, 1974, what is believed to be the last letter sent by the Zodiac Killer was published by the Chronicle. It is referred to as the Exorcist letter. This letter included him discussing the Exorcist movie by William Friedkin in 1973. His letter was most likely a response to the San Francisco Chronicle article entitled, "Where are things going on at the movies?" After this letter, the Zodiac Killer just disappeared. However, the mystery still remains. After all the pain and misery that the Zodiac Killer caused, who was the Zodiac Killer really? There are several theories on who the Zodiac really was. Number 1. Arthur Lee Allen. This theory is proposed by Robert Graysmith's books. Arthur Lee Allen was often considered the prime suspect in the Zodiac Killer case. And after the release of Gray Smith's book, The Zodiac, it popularized the belief that Allen was the killer. Arthur Lee Allen grew up in Vallejo, California, and he eventually joined the Navy. However, he was dishonorably discharged from the Navy in 1958. Additionally, in 1968, he was fired from his job as an elementary teacher after he was caught molesting children. In 1974, he was arrested again for molesting children. According to Karen Allen, his sister-in-law, he had had an interest in killing animals and torturing bugs from an early age. While Allen is often considered the prime suspect of the Zodiac Killer case, the evidence against him is quite circumstantial. While there is some direct evidence, such as surviving victim Mike McGow choosing him out of a police lineup, as well as surviving victim Brian Hartnell identifying his voice and physical appearance, that is where the direct evidence ends. There is also a lot of circumstantial evidence against Allen. According to his friend, Don Chenet, Allen had a lot of disturbing novel ideas that linked very closely to the Zodiac killings. It's important to note that he proposed these ideas before the Zodiac killings began. He proposed the idea that in the novel, he would kill couples randomly, taunt the police with letters detailing his crimes, signing his letters with cross circle symbol from his watch, and even went as far to call himself the Zodiac. Adding on to this, there was more circumstantial evidence connecting him to the case, and it is believed that he knew Darlene Farren. However, due to the lack of direct evidence, the police were unable to bring Allen in. While there is evidence that points that Allen might have been the Zodiac killer, there is quite a bit of evidence that says the opposite. The eyewitnesses of the Stein murder scene claim that Allen was not the man they saw. Additionally, the fingerprints and palm prints of Allen did not match the Zodiac killer prints. The DNA did not match either. Lastly, his appearance did not match the one that was drawn in the sketch. Allen died from heart failure on August 26, 1992. Because of this, the police were not able to fully question him. Number 2. Lawrence Kane Kay. This theory is proposed by Harvey Hines. Lawrence Kane Kay was known for the different aliases he would use, such as Larry Kane. He would often alter his appearance and had a lengthy criminal rap sheet that went all the way back to the 1940s. The main evidence linking Kane to this case was the fact that Pam Huckabee, the sister of Darlene Farren, claimed that Kane had been following her sister for months before she was murdered. Additionally, a possible Zodiac victim named Kathleen Johns identified Kane as her abductor. Another factor to consider was the fact that, as a result of massive brain damage in a 1962 auto accident, Kane had been diagnosed by a psychologist with losing the ability to control self-gratification. Kane also served in the Naval Reserves, where it's believed that he learned how to use coding. He was arrested several times for peeping and prowling. Lastly, the man seen by Officer Don Fouquet was believed to be 35 to 45 years old in 1969. Kane was 45 during this time. The officer also said that Kane was the closest of them as he remembered the killer. However, again, most of the evidence against Kane was circumstantial. Number 3. Earl Van Best Jr. This theory is proposed by his son, Gary Stewart. While this theory is often considered the weakest, one thing was sure, and that was that Earl Van Best Jr. was not a good person. He had already made the newspapers in the early 60s when at age 28 he began a relationship with a 14-year-old girl. He eventually met Judy Chandler at an ice cream parlor and then married her. When she was pregnant with their son Gary Stewart at only 15, Van Best had already been imprisoned for statutory rape. He was said to be an abusive father, and he abandoned his one-month-old son in Louisiana. Stewart was eventually adopted and did not learn the truth about his parents until 2002, when his biological mother, Judy, contacted him. Van Best would eventually die in Mexico in 1984 after being charged with DUIs, fraud, rape, pedophilia, and more. In Gary Stewart's 2014 book, The Most Dangerous Animal of All, Stewart makes the case that his father was the Zodiac Killer. However, similar to the cases against Allen and Kane, Stewart's evidence against his father was circumstantial, and he lacked the direct evidence to support that his father was actually the Zodiac. Stewart heavily relied on the physical similarities between the two, as well as concealed files he believed contained connections between his father and the Zodiac killings. Additionally, Stewart mentions how his father resembles the composite sketch of the Zodiac. He lived in California at the time of the killings and was interested in ciphers. He also mentioned how his father might have had a grudge against San Francisco Chronicle reporter Paul Avery. Avery wrote a series of articles about Best and Stewart's mother. Stewart also claimed to have found Van Best's initials in the Zodiac ciphers, as well as have a document examiner say that the handwriting on Van Best's marriage certificate matched the Zodiac's. Stewart's claims were quickly shut down by experts due to most of his evidence being questionable. The method he used to crack the cipher was questionable, and the fingerprint mark was similar to the Zodiac only if it was reversed. Additionally, the handwriting on the marriage certificate was a minister's, not Van Best's. Due to the lack of evidence, Best is usually ruled out when considering suspects. Without being able to pinpoint who the Zodiac really was, it is hard to fully understand why he thought the way he did, and why he committed the crimes that he did. From the several letters and the ciphers that he created and sent, it seems that the Zodiac Killer got psychological gratification from creating fear and panic. He also got this gratification from toying with the police officers and investigators. He enjoyed their fear and watching people squirm. This can also be seen in how he insisted that the people of the Bay Area would have to wear the Zodiac buttons, or he would bomb the area. He wrote several times in his letters that if people did not wear the symbol of the Zodiac, he would continue to kill and send bomb threats. Dr. Lawrence Friedman believed that the Zodiac Killer led a terror-dominated life. He asserted his power due to feeling powerless. He also suggests that the Zodiac Killer's behavior indicated how he could possibly be insane and suicidal. Another psychologist named William F. Baker believed that the Zodiac was most likely paranoid or schizophrenic. The latest theory about the Zodiac Killer's psychological state was that he suffered from dissociative identity disorder, also known as DID. This theory states that after the Zodiac Killer got treatment for the disorder, he recovered and his desire to kill simply disappeared. The Zodiac killing's pattern was random, and the killing was a sport for him. He was both an organized and a disorganized offender, meaning that he was a mixed type of killer. It seems that the Zodiac killer's main motive was to demonstrate his superiority and power over his victims. He enjoyed abusing his victims, and through choosing couples to target, could have hated relationship and women. He craved the attention, and it fueled him and boosted his ego. He wanted people to see how he was in charge, and how even the police couldn't catch him. Psychologically speaking, the Zodiac Killer is believed to show narcissistic traits. He craved attention, he was arrogant, and still insecure. While the Zodiac Killer's identity remains a mystery to this day, it is clear that he left a huge dark blood stain on Northern California, especially the San Francisco area.